So this is Ryan from Hip Hop Kings speaking with Masta Ace. How are you doing, sir?
I'm good, man. What's going on?
Good, good. We're here in Brooklyn in the studio. And I just want to say firstly, congratulations on the reissue of the classic Disposable Arts album.
Thank you.
What gave you the idea originally, other than the anniversary, to go through the process of a reissue with the album?
Well, you know, when the record first came out, it went out of print almost immediately. Within a month of the record coming out, it was out of print. And so only the copies that were put out initially were available, and many, many people wanted to get the album. And so there was a high demand for the CD as well as the vinyl. And the prices were, once you see the prices going up on eBay to like, you know, $80, $100 and stuff like that, then you know that there's a demand for it. And so we basically, I did a deal with a company, HHV, to do the vinyl, and then I did a deal a couple of years later with Below System to do the CD. And now it's available to fans, and I can sell them at shows, and it's just a great thing. It's a necessary, if you're a fan of what I do, then, you know, Disposable Arts is one of those that have to be in your collection.
And we're going to touch on the documentary a bit later, but did you have any issues with having the go-ahead as the label previously who released it didn't exist, or was it a case of you had complete control to be able to re-release the album again?
Oh, once J. Cole went out of business, all the ownership reverted back to us. They breached the agreement in the first place, so we owned it outright. We could do whatever we want with the record, and that's a great feeling, because I don't own the rights to my very first album, and so people, you know, ask me about that first album, and I don't even promote that album because I don't have the right to do anything with that album. So I learned from that first record that it's better to be able to own your stuff, to be able to do what you want with it down the road after your deals have dried up, that you can still take your record, do different things with it, and that's what we've been doing.
And what, looking back at it now, what elements of the album do you think made it a timeless piece of work that fans still consider a classic to this day?
I think what fans love the most about Disposable Arts is the storyline and the way that it carries you from the very beginning. You know, my character getting out of jail on too long, and going to the Institute of Disposable Arts, this imaginary school, and then kind of the stories within the stories, the girlfriend Lisa and her issues with an ex-boyfriend, and her trying to encourage my character to go sell drugs on the streets with her brothers, and her getting robbed for the car, and you know, the ex-boyfriend trying to steal the car back, and there's a song that actually speaks to that part of it. It's like the storyline is interweaved within the songs, which are interweaved within the lyrics, and you get the story from beginning to end, and I think that's what fans love about it.
And I think as well, just to add, that the title Disposable Arts, unfortunately, is still very relevant in today's music. You know, people are forever changing to stick with what's hot rather than trying to make your timeless music like that as well. So from a fan's point of view, I guess it's very much still relevant as well. What were your favorite tracks from the album?
Definitely Alphabet Soup is one of my favorite tracks. Going through the alphabet the way that I did and telling the story the whole way, and you know, challenging the listener to find the letters, and to the fact that you could listen to it if you just didn't know anything about the alphabet thing being done, that it's still telling a story. There's nothing that stands out and goes, oh, he's trying to do letters. Like, you would never even pay attention to it if you didn't know. If I named it something else, if I called it anything else, you would never know that that's what the song was. So that's one of my favorites. Unfriendly Game is definitely another one featuring Strickland. That record, you know, was in kind of an ode to Main Source, Friendly Game of Baseball. And I just love the way Strick and I kind of handled the analogy of drug dealing and football and kind of tried to keep those two, tried to tell a story about drug dealing and using football and sports analogies within the rhyme. That was a fun record to write. Every Other Day is another real big favorite of mine, featuring Mr. Leegee and Sauce, little reggae flavor on that joint. When I used to perform that album, that was the record a lot of times I would come out to. That would be like the first song coming out on stage. It's just such a triumphant feeling record. And it's just an exciting record in a lot of ways. I remember getting that beat and immediately knowing exactly, I had to flow immediately. Like, I remember writing it in the gym. I was with Filthy Rich and DJ Rob. We were all working out. And I had the beat. Back then it was carrying the CD. CD Walkman was what you had back then. No iPods. And playing the CD Walkman with the beat going over and over again, and coming up with the lyrics for that. That's just a few, man. Pretty much all those records on the album, but those are kind of three of the standouts for me.
And I know you touched on it again in the documentary, but Take a Walk, I guess you didn't have the anticipation that it would be such a crowd favourite, I guess. Is that right to say?
I actually was remiss in mentioning Take a Walk. Definitely should be in the top three of my favorites on the album. Definitely didn't expect the type of a reaction. I knew that when I heard the beat, I knew that it was going to be a great record. I was going to love the record. I thought it would be, you know, at best an album cut that was a cool album cut. I didn't know that it would turn into, you know, a song that wasn't a single, no video, and every show people are yelling out that title, like, you're not getting off stage until you do Take a Walk. Never would have anticipated that, but love performing that record. It's so much fun when that record comes on, seeing the crowd's reaction. And I think it's one of those records that, for as long as I'm performing, that'll be a record that I have to do.
Cool. So moving on to the documentary, it's just under 2 hours long. It's certainly worth the watch if the fans who are watching this haven't seen it already. Whose idea was it originally to go through with the documentary? Was it yours?
It was my idea to do the documentary. I just wanted to pay respect to that album, because that album, you know, by itself alone has extended my career going on, you know, 15 years. And artists like myself and from the era that I'm from, you don't get those kind of lifelines. You don't get those kind of extensions on your career unless you have some really, you know, classic first album or classic hit record that is undeniable in hip-hop history, and I didn't have that. But this album, you know, solidified me as an artist who can put out consistently good albums, and people have followed my career because of that. But I owe a lot to Disposable Arts, and I felt like a documentary about the making of it would shed some light on the inner workings of that record, and kind of I want people to know how it came about, why it came about, what the process was of making the records. And I was happy that we were able to reach back to some of the people that were on the record and have them, you know, give their insight on recording on that record. It was kind of cool hearing other people's perspective, because some of the stories that people told, I didn't remember some of those details. So that's why it was cool to bring in, you know, the Rod Diggers, the Sabor. I hadn't seen Sabor since we did the record. Explicit. I hadn't seen him for many, many years. Since Long Hot Summer, I hadn't seen him. So, Domingo, I hadn't seen for a really long time. So being able to get all of those people on camera talking about their contribution just made it a well worthwhile project.
Yeah, and I agree. I mean, again, for those who have seen it, I think they'll completely agree that it's a great insight into the album, but more so with some of the stories that are told, the likes of how Hellbound came around with Eminem and how he missed out on the, you know, on the album and things like that. So it's a really good insight into what fans wouldn't normally have heard.
Right.
And it's just a good tribute to the album, really. What attracted you to go with Below System Records for kind of the CD reissue? Because they appear to be very kind of supportive in what you're trying to achieve, really.
Yeah, Below System, I went with them because they actually had enthusiasm and interest in putting the record back out. Like, it, this wasn't a thing where I went around to distributors and labels trying to get somebody to reissue the record. Like, they came to me and they were like, we would like to do a deal with you to put out Disposable and Aloha Summer on CD because it's not out there. And it was a no-brainer for me. I was happy with the fact that they were going to give me quality packaging. Like, they didn't go and try to cut corners and do a jewel case or something that cheapened the project. They went nicer. You know, the originally Disposable was a jewel case, and they did a digipack, full fold out, like, nice. And once I saw, you know, what their vision was, and they saw that I had a documentary that was already shot, they got their editor in, and, you know, we collaborated on it, and I'm just really happy with the result.
It's interesting, because I believe they're based in Holland, aren't they? So they're not even US-based from what I'm...
No, they're from Holland. They're from the Netherlands.
So it's just excellent how you can collaborate now with people who aren't even in the same country to create such good work. So the last few questions, really, is following the success of the reissue and the documentary, will there be plans to do a similar thing with A Long Hot Summer in a few years?
Yeah, Long Hot Summer, we actually, a little over a year ago, started shooting the documentary for A Long Hot Summer. The company that Below System hired to shoot the footage decided that, well, let's put it like this. We fell out with them. So we're starting from scratch. They have that footage that they can't use. They can go and friggin' do whatever the hell they want with it. We're starting this summer filming from scratch a Aloha Summer documentary, and it will be coming out very soon.